the Nintendo Game Boy Color remains my favorite portable vintage video game system. In fact, I prefer it over playing games on my iPhone because I like to have tactile controls that I can feel with my fingers and that aren't covering up part of my screen. The problem is, almost all Game Boys ever made include a reflective LCD screen that's just really hard to see without light coming in at just the right angle. Ironically, most of my favorite games are actually games designed for the original black and white Game Boy. There are many reasons for this, but I think one of the big reasons is because by the 1990s we'd really made some dramatic increases in the capabilities of graphics in various different game consoles and computers, and I think that game developers were too busy trying to wow consumers with graphics and they kind of forgot that games need to have good gameplay. And so those sort of games that they made don't tend to hold up today because it takes quite a bit to impress somebody these days with graphics, because our computers and our phones and our tablets can do pretty much anything regarding graphics. So if the game doesn't have good gameplay, then there's really not much there to see. For example, as strange as it may sound, I actually prefer to play the original Pitfall on my Atari 2600 in all of its pixelated glory than to play the Game Boy Color version of Pitfall. And while the graphics are much better, for some reason the game just doesn't interest me. Surprisingly, most of these games actually do have some color to them, even though they were designed for the black and white model. And that's because they included small amounts of color data so that when used with the Super Game Boy adapter for the Super Nintendo, you could have some color. So that's why I prefer to play these games on a Game Boy Color instead of the original. That, along with the fact that it's an active matrix screen, so it has better contrast. Back in 2014, in one of my earliest videos, I modified a Game Boy Pocket so that it would have a backlight. Sure, you can modify a Game Boy Advance with a backlit screen, but I never felt like this was real, authentic Game Boy experience because of the layout and the fact that the screen was the wrong aspect ratio and size for original Game Boy games. So at the time, I figured this was the most authentic way to enjoy original Game Boy games because there was no way to add a backlight to a Game Boy Color. Until now. I also hesitate to even do any videos right now on Nintendo products because Nintendo the company has been acting like a jackass lately. And one of the things they've been doing is they've been falsely accusing several YouTubers of copyright violations, even when no copyrights were actually violated. I mean, particularly when they were using things under fair use. But most YouTubers, like me, don't have an army of lawyers to help defend them like Nintendo does. So that's one thing. And secondly, they forced takedowns of the Commodore 64 port of Super Mario Bros., which in no way affected their bottom line, since it isn't like anyone playing this 34-year-old game on a Commodore 64 is going to cause Nintendo a lost sale or something. So it really reminds me a lot of CBS suing their own Star Trek fan base for financing Star Trek fan films because they weren't bothering to create any new Star Trek. I mean, it's just really bad tactics that don't accomplish anything other than making them look like a jackass. Nevertheless, today I'm going to show you how to modify a Game Boy Color to add a backlit screen. Okay, so let's get started. Disassembling the Game Boy Color is actually pretty easy. However, you will need a special type of screwdriver known as a tri-wing. It's really similar to a Phillips, but it has three wings instead of four. And Nintendo used this on a lot of their products, among other weird screws, to keep people from opening them up. Of course, today they're easy to find on Amazon or eBay. Anyway, so they're just four screws on the back, and which I always advise storing properly so you don't lose them. And then there are two more screws in the battery compartment. And then it should just come right apart like so. Next, I'll remove the power switch and the IR lens. Now we need to disconnect this ribbon cable. This is one of those locking cables, so you can use your fingernail or a tool like this to unlock it. And there we go. Next, there are some Phillips screws holding the board down. And there we go, the board is out. So far, this process is surprisingly easy. I'll remove the buttons and pads and store them safely out of the way. Okay, here's where things start to get a little more complicated. The screen is glued in place, but there is a trick for removing it. Just grab it like this and twist. And there it goes, it popped loose. Now just keep working it until it comes out completely. And there you have it, the old screen is removed. You'll also need to remove this screen protector, and the way you do that is just push from the inside like this, and just be gentle with it and work around the edges slowly, and there you go. Okay, so let's take a look at this box from Midwest Embedded. So what this actually is a brand new screen. It's a modern backlit LCD. The LCD is exactly twice the resolution of the original Game Boy Color screen in both directions. On the back is a custom FPGA designed to receive the Game Boy Color signals and display them on this screen. Now, since this screen has a native resolution that is doubled in both directions, it makes it fairly simple to scale an image and keep it looking exactly like the original. So, for every 1 pixel the Game Boy transmits, this screen will light up 4 pixels instead. And here it is compared with the original screen I just removed. Ok, so the new screen will go down like this, but this little ribbon cable on the left is in the way, so some slight case modifications will be required there. I'll just use a Sharpie to mark each side like this, and I'll draw a little line to show exactly the area that needs to be removed. And the easiest way to remove this chunk of plastic is simply by cutting it with some wire cutters like this on each side. And then you can just grab it with some pliers. I'm having trouble getting my pliers to fit on one side, so I'll pry the piece over some first. And there we go, piece removed. According to the instructions, the next thing I need to do is cut out this template. So I'll do that, and here we go. I'm not quite sure what I'm supposed to do with this. It does fit perfectly in the screen protector area. I think I'm supposed to cut out that little notch on the right. As such, I cut the inside part of the template out some, and now I can see exactly where I need to cut. And for this job, I'm going to use my trusty Dremel. I actually scored this a bit on one side, so it should snap pretty easily. And there we go. Of course, it's not a super clean cut, so I'll just follow that up with a little file. And there we go, that's just about perfect. It was at this point I realized I had made a mistake. Now, when I tried to fit the screen in, I realized that the template I was looking at earlier actually needed me to cut the whole inside of the screen back some, not just that little notch. So that meant getting the Dremel back out again. And this was going to be much more difficult than I originally thought. I always go really slow when cutting plastics because it is so easy for the Dremel to jump suddenly and then slice a big piece of plastic you didn't mean to slice. I also make sure to cut inside the lines, which leaves room for me to clean it up with a file. There's an old saying that it's better to cut too little than to cut too much, because you can always file down what you missed, but you can't put back plastic once you've cut it off. I'm also going to need to remove this adhesive because it's covered in plastic dust now, and fortunately most of it will scrape off with my fingernail. And then I can remove the residue with some alcohol. And here it is after all of the cutting and filing is done. I'm also going to need to remove the adhesive from this screen protector, and I decided to go with WD-40 because it works a bit more gently than alcohol, and I was worried about messing up the clear plastic. So, I let this sit for a bit, and I was able to remove most of the adhesive. However, I did have to follow it up with alcohol to get it clean, and unfortunately, it ended up looking like this. And that's actually not damaged, but rather it's just a fine layer of smeared adhesive. So, I had to apply more WD-40 and let it sit for a while to better dissolve all of that. And here is the finished product. Okay, we're getting closer to seeing if this is all going to work. I'm going to need to attach the new screen to the board, which is a perfect fit, and I'll just lock down this cable. Now, looking at the other side, it will be necessary to solder a single wire. It needs to go from VCC here on the board, which is basically means a power supply, and it goes to VCC on the board near the power switch. And this is how the screen gets power. Now, this is actually the only wire that is necessary. However, if you desire, there are also 3 more pads here called down, up, and select. And what you would do with these is run wires down to the test points near the buttons like this. And what this mod would allow you to do is change the brightness by holding down the select button and pushing up or down on the D-pad. I'm not going to bother with this mod unless I feel the brightness needs adjusting. Since I no longer have any adhesive on my screen protector, I'm going to cut some out of this double-sided tape. And I'll just apply the tape all around the screen and then use a razor knife to cut off any excess, which should leave a perfect amount behind. So now I'll put the screen down in the case, and it does seem to fit now. I'll reassemble everything else. I'm not going to screw it back together just yet, but I want to see if it works. And it does! Not only does it work, it looks amazing. I'll go ahead and put the screen protector back on. I just cleaned the screen with a microfiber cloth first. Okay, I think the adhesive is going to work fine, and I'll give the outside a little polish. And I'll go ahead and screw everything else back together. Okay, so how does it look? Well, it looks amazing. I mean, with the screen protector back on, you can barely tell that there's anything different about the Game Boy Color, but the backlit screen is just absolutely amazing. And as I mentioned earlier, I really love to play the original Game Boy titles like these. And they look better than I've ever seen them before. Okay, time for some comparisons. This is the only game that I happen to own two copies of, so I'll take another Game Boy Color that is not modified, and we'll do a little side-by-side comparison. So, this game does have some color, but since it was designed for the black and white Game Boy, it only has minimal amounts of color. But what we're looking at here is the contrast, a viewing angle, and just overall visibility. Of course, right now I'm holding this at an angle that the light works best for the older reflective model, but when I change angles, you can clearly see the backlit model is way better. And of course, if I turn the light out in the room, then the original model becomes unplayable. However, I could keep playing this one in the dark with no problem. How does this compare to the GB Boy Color that I reviewed a while back? Well, this cheap Game Boy Color knockoff works well enough, and it does have a backlit screen, but my biggest complaint about it was that the pixel arrangement on the screen is really meant for playback of video or maybe a digital camera or something like that, and so with games, everything just appears to have really rough edges. And so I want to show you some close-ups I took of the screens of all three units. Now, this is the original Game Boy with the reflective screen. This is the same game shown on the GB Boy Color, and you can see how jagged everything looks. And then this is the new modified Game Boy Color. Which one looks best to you? Well, for me, there's no question. This latest mod is the best choice. Okay, a next comparison. How does this one stand up next to the Game Boy Pocket that I modified with the backlight a few years ago? Well, both of them can be played in the dark, which is nice, but I think you'll see the new Game Boy Color screen has a lot more contrast to it. And this boils down to the fact that the Game Boy Pocket used a passive matrix screen, and the Game Boy Color, even the reflective model, used an active matrix screen. And I think we're all spoiled today with active matrix screens and everything, so I don't think my Game Boy Pocket will be getting much use anymore. I'll put a link down in the description field of where you can buy the backlit screen if you are so inclined to do the mod yourself. And I guess that about wraps it up for this episode. So, as always, thanks for watching.